day, grade 11s. Welcome to this next lesson in science. Okay, up to now we've been working, well, for the last couple of lessons, been working on two-body systems. And I want to do another example on a two-body system. Remember that two-body systems use Newton's second law, which is why we are doing it. Remember, I also said too that two-body systems are like a firm favorite at the moment. They're very fashionable to be asked, both in grade 11 and grade 12. So I've been going through quite a few examples. So if you've missed those, go back and watch the old videos. And we will do one more example, and then we're going to move on to Newton's third law and the universal law of gravity. Grade 11s, I'd really like to encourage you to join our TurnAble class. The main reason I would like you to join the TurnAble class is because then you can message me, which means you can ask me questions either about the work that we've done, or you can request sections to be completed or to be revised with you guys. Or if you've got exam questions or test questions that you want answered that you don't quite understand, you're welcome to message me on that. Okay, so what we're going to do now is get started. So it says a force of 60 newtons is applied to a 5 kilogram block, okay, at an angle of 10 degrees to the horizontal, causing the block to accelerate to the left. So they're telling you it's accelerating to the left, okay? They tell you the coefficient of the kinetic friction between the 5 kilogram block and the surface of the table is 0.5. Okay, so they're telling you that mu k is 0.5, but what are they really telling you? They're telling you there's a force of friction. There's a force of friction. And remember that the force of friction is always parallel to the surface, and it is always in the opposite direction to the motion. Okay. Now, what is important with what we've just done is we have read through the information and we've applied it in our diagram. And that is very, very important. Grade 11s, I find a lot of my students will jump into the first question that says, draw a labeled free body diagram showing all the forces acting on the 5 kilogram block. And because they haven't read this, they didn't realize that there was a force of friction, which means they leave out the force of friction in this free body diagram, and so on and so on and so on. So, because you need the free body diagram to be able to answer all the other questions, etc., etc. So it is very important that you read the information they provide. And I'd like to suggest you use your reading time in tests and exams. I know in tests they don't really give you reading time, but in exams you definitely get 10 minutes reading time. And I would really urge you to read through this information and then look at the picture and see if this picture has all the information in it. Okay. Now it says draw a labeled free body diagram showing all the forces acting on the 5 kilogram block. And again, what I'd like to say to you is that even if they don't ask you to draw a free body diagram, draw one, because it's going to help you to understand what forces are acting on this so that you can answer the questions. Okay, so what's important about a free body diagram is that you've got a dot, or as one of my students likes to say, a colored in circle, because it's a really big dot. Okay, also what's important about these questions is you'll notice there's no mark allocation here, but in the exams I would say 99% of the time, the number of marks that they give to the question is the number of forces acting on the object. Okay, so if this is for 3 marks, you're probably expected to draw 3 forces. If it's for 4 forces, etc., etc. Okay, so let's talk about this. Do you agree, as always, there is a force of gravity? And since the table is holding this 5 kilogram block up, there is a normal force, F normal. You could have also called this the force of the table on the block, that is fine. And then there is the applied force, which is at an angle of 10 degrees. This is F applied. And there is the force of friction, which is in the opposite direction. Okay, so my students often ask me, couple of things about this. One is, do you need to put numbers in? Okay, no, you don't. When we're talking about labeled free body diagram, we're talking about force applied, Fn, Fg, and Ff. Okay, that is fine. What does need to happen is that your diagram needs to be in pencil. You need to use an eraser if you make a mistake. I don't want to see lines that do this. Oops, I didn't mean to draw it quite that long. No, you need an eraser, and that's why you have to do it in pencil. Next, you need to use a ruler. These lines are supposed to be straight, and they're supposed to be touching the circle. So a drawing that looks like that is not a free body diagram. It's a horrible thing. I don't know what it is, but it's not a free body diagram. Okay, so it needs to be, we're using a ruler. Obviously, my software, yeah, doesn't allow me to have a slapped grid or anything like that. So this is the best I can do. Then obviously you need your labels. Then the last thing you need to look out for is your length of your lines, your length of your arrows. And yes, you do need to have arrows because these are representing forces. Now, the length of the arrows have to be approximately the length of the appropriate length for the forces. In other words, the normal force and the force of gravity actually balance each other out. If they didn't, if the force of gravity was bigger than the normal force, then this block would fall through the table. Or if the normal force is bigger than the force of gravity, then the block would be somehow rising up into the air through, I don't know, using the force, I don't know, but it would be going up, okay? Secondly, we also know that the force of the acceleration is bigger than the force of friction because they tell you the block is accelerating to the left. So therefore, we know that this applied force is bigger than the force of friction. And they do look for that, okay? So the way these things are marked is they're marked negatively. In other words, you start off with your four marks because this would have been a four mark question. And then they subtract marks. So if you don't have the force of friction, or if the force of friction is really long, or if it's in the wrong direction, then you lose a mark, etc., etc. Okay. So those are the things you need to look for when you're drawing your free body diagram. And quite candidly, a free body diagram is actually a fairly easy way to get marks. So I would suggest you make sure that you can draw them. Also, if you draw your free body diagram correctly, you can cruise the rest of the question. You really can, because this helps you solve the rest of the question. Okay, next part of the question says, calculate the magnitude of the vertical component of the 60 newtons. Okay, so I'm going to draw it up here just to make it easier for myself. They want the magnitude of the vertical component of the 60 newtons. The magnitude of a vertical component. Okay, so the nice thing about this is a right angle triangle. We know that this here is 60 newtons because this is actually the applied force, and that is the hypotenuse. We want the vertical component, which I'm gonna call Fv, okay? And Fv is the opposite. So we need to think about Sakatoa. Okay, so we want the opposite side and we've got the hypotenuse. So we can say that sine of 10 degrees is equal to the opposite, which is the vertical component, over the hypotenuse of 60. So we've got 60 sine 10 degrees is equal to the vertical component. And now we need to get out our calculator. And as I say in every single lesson, and yes, I know you guys are bored of hearing it, you guys need to check that your calculator, it doesn't matter if it's a HP or a Casio or a Sharp, which you guys usually use, you need to check that there is either a capital D here, but more importantly, that there's no capital R, because the capital R represents radians. And if you are doing this using radians, then you're going to get it wrong. Okay, so because radians is a whole nother measure of angles, so you're going to get it wrong if you're using radians. So I would suggest you make sure that it is a capital D. If you're not sure, at the back of your calculator, there is usually a little indentation and it says reset. Okay, there's a little button and you can press reset. Otherwise, you need to go into your mode and or your setup and go and look for the angle situation and make sure that it is degrees. But but make sure. Otherwise, I had one matric who did his whole paper using radians, and it was terrible because he was an A candidate. And obviously, he didn't get his A at the end of the year because, yeah, most of his physics paper was wrong. So 10.418. Okay, we always round off to two decimal places, which means we look at the third number here. Okay, the third decimal place, which is an 8. So what we need to do is round that up, because this is an 8, so it becomes 10.42. So therefore, the vertical component is 10.42. And what is it measured in? It's measured in newtons. Okay, cool. Next question. Now it says calculate the magnitude of the horizontal component. Okay, so this is actually quite an easy question so far, because this is really basic trig. So they want the horizontal component, So therefore, we're going to use the adjacent and the hypotenuse, and we are going to use cos. Now, some of you might be tempted to use this 10.42 and the 60 and use Pythagoras. I would say to you, please don't do that, because let's say you messed up. Let's say you wrote 60 sine 10 degrees, and then for some reason you put in 60 sine 20 on your calculator. You just weren't concentrating properly and you messed up and you put the wrong number in, and you end up with the wrong vertical component. Then if you then work this out based on that wrong number, this is going to be wrong, which means you compounded errors the whole way through. And yes, there are method marks, but there's only so many method marks we can give you, okay? So you need to be careful of that. So you need to be much better to always use the information that you were given originally, if you can. Obviously, there's some situations when we can't. So we've got the hypotenuse, we've got the angle, we want the adjacent, we're going to use cos. So we've got cos of 10 degrees equals the adjacent, which is the horizontal component, over the hypotenuse, which is 60. So we've got 60 cos 10 degrees is equal to FH. And again, we get out the calculator and we go 60 cos, cos 10, close the bracket, equals, and that becomes 59.088. So the 8 means we round this up, so it becomes 59.09. So that becomes 59.09 newtons is the horizontal component. And we kind of expected that, because this degree is so small, okay? So that's 59.09, and while I'm at it, I'm just gonna write in the vertical component, that's 10.42. Right, next question. Calculate the magnitude of the normal force acting on the 5 kilogram block. Now, this, although it seems easy, is actually slightly tricky, because normally there is no vertical component holding the block up, okay? So what happens is that normally this normal force equals the force of gravity, as we mentioned earlier. In this case, we have this component of the applied force, which together with the normal force match the force of gravity, because this object is not moving. This 5 kilogram block is not moving vertically, okay? It's moving horizontally, but it's not moving vertically, which means that this force, the vertical component of the applied force plus the normal force, has to equal the force of gravity, but in the opposite direction. Okay, so let me write it to you this way. Do you agree that F net vertically is zero? Okay, it is not moving in a vertical direction. It is only moving towards the right, okay? But F net is always considered to be the sum of all the forces in that specific plane, right? Which in this case is F normal plus the force of gravity plus the vertical component, okay, of the applied force. Okay, now that has to all equal zero, but now we need to decide on a direction being positive, because these forces are not in all the same direction. So we're gonna choose up as positive. Okay, it's just assigning a direction as a positive, right? Therefore, we've got F normal plus minus the force of gravity. But the force of gravity is mass times acceleration due to gravity plus the force of the vertical component, which is 10,42. And that all equals zero. So we've got zero is equal to Fn. Now remember that this is in the opposite direction, it's downwards. So it becomes minus the mass, which is 5, minus times by 9.8, plus 10,42. So zero is equal to Fn, and now we can put this in our calculator. So we can say, minus bracket 5 times 9.8 close bracket plus 10.42 equals SD button minus 38.48. So this becomes minus 38,48. Therefore, do you agree that the F normal is 38,48 newtons? So this F normal is 38,48 newtons. Sure, it's a bit small. Let me rewrite it. Okay, let me write it. It is going to be 38,48. There is a reason I'm writing all my information there. Okay, right. So now we've got the normal force acting on the 5 kilogram block. Okay, so up to now, it hasn't been a bad question. Do you agree? You could work out the vertical component. You could work out the horizontal component. This was a little bit tricky. This wasn't a straight level one question. This was a little bit like level three. You had to realize that the applied force, the vertical component, the applied force was playing with the bit of the normal force. Okay, so this is a bit trickier. Next, it now says, calculate the magnitude of the tension in the string connecting the two blocks. Okay, and this is the question. This is the question that we've been building up to. This is the question that's either like 7 or 8 marks because we now need to work out the tension in the string. And what I'd like to suggest you do is you draw a free body diagram of the other object, the 2 kilogram. It is always good to have a free body diagram of the 2 kilogram of all of them. Okay, right. So let's just do that. So here is your 2 kilogram. Ah, I left out a force. I left out a force. I left out the tension. Oh, I'm so sorry. I left out the tension. How bad is that? Sorry, guys. I totally forgot about this tension. Okay, so now we can remember that there's a tension, and the tension, we don't know if the tension is bigger than the force of friction or not, so you're kind of given away with that, okay? You don't know, so you can have either drawn the tension smaller or bigger than. Sorry, can't believe I did that. Okay, right, so now you've got the force of gravity down due to the 2 kilogram, this is a 2 kilogram, and you've got the tension up. Okay, right, now, what do we need to do? We need to find the tension in the string connecting the two blocks. Do you agree that this thing is one whole unit? And as a whole unit, we know it's accelerating to the right. Okay, we know it's accelerating to the right. Okay, so let's have a look, and I'm going to do it in 2 different colors. So let's talk about the 5 kilogram. Now for the 5 kilogram, we know that we've got F net. Okay, and F net is always the sum of all the forces, and we're now just talking about the horizontal components. So we've got this horizontal component here, which is the horizontal component of the applied force, F horizontal, plus we've got the force of friction, plus we've got the tension. Okay, now I know you're shouting at me and you're saying, but some of these are positive and some of these are negative. I know, but you always need to show that you guys know that the net force is the sum of all the forces, Always, okay? That's your definition. And there's a mark allocated for this, okay? If you feel really badly about this, you can go, well, I've chosen the direction of movement as positive, right? And therefore, we can say that we've got force of horizontal plus minus the force of friction plus minus the tension. Both of those are right. But the point is that you need to show that you know that the sum of all the forces gives you the net force. Okay, right, happy with that. So we know that F net is equal to the F horizontal, which we've already worked out. It is 59,09 plus minus the force of friction. And this is why they asked us to work out this normal force, because the force of friction is mu K Fn, okay? And then you've got minus the tension. Okay, and this F net is equal to the mass of the object, which is 5 times the acceleration. We don't know what the acceleration is. It just says it's accelerating to the left. We know nothing else, okay? Right, so we know that 5A is equal to 59,09. And yes, I am doing this slowly. I'm doing it slowly so that you guys can see all the steps that we need to do, okay? If you can do it faster, that's great. But I'm doing it slowly so make sure that you all understand what I'm doing, okay? So the mu k is 0.5, so it's about 0.5. And then this Fn we know is 38.48. So that's 38,48 minus t. Okay, so we've got 5A is equal to 59,09 minus, let's put that in our calculators. So you've got 0.5 times 38.48 equals 19.24. So that becomes 19,24. Minus t. So therefore 5a is equal to, and let's just subtract that from your 59.09, so minus 59.09 equals, okay, becomes 39.85 minus t. And we're going to call this equation 1. Okay, and I know for a fact that you guys have done some of these equations already, so this shouldn't be too bad for you, okay? So this is a 5 kilogram. Now I'm going to show you why I said you always should do a free body diagram for the other object, and that's because we need a second equation. So we're talking now about the 2 kilogram. Now because these guys are a unit joined by the string, okay, they are going to accelerate at the same acceleration. They're going to move across at exactly the same acceleration. If they didn't, something would happen with the string. Either the string would have slack or it would break, okay? They have to move at exactly the same acceleration to the right, to the left, in order for this to have tension. Okay, so therefore we can say that F net for the 2 kilogram is again the sum of all the forces, which is going to be T plus the force of gravity. Okay. T plus the force of gravity. Okay. So what happens next? We've got the net force, which is made up of the mass that we're talking about, which is 2 times the acceleration. The tension, now remember we chose the direction to the left as positive. So if we chose the direction to the left as positive, then this tension is also going to be positive because it's going in the same direction. So if we've got T plus minus the force of gravity, which again is just going to be 2 times by 9,8, and I'm going to put a change this to a minus. Okay, so we've got 2A is equal to T minus 19,6, and that is equation 2. Now there are 2 ways you can do this. I know that we're solving for tension. Now the one way to do this is to solve this for A or solve this for A and then let them be equal. The other way to do it I apologize for the break. I hope you guys are still here. Unfortunately, the council decided in their wisdom to make our electricity just switch off from the outside, so we had no control over it. And now I'm just trying to get the video feedback, which is giving me a little bit of hassles, but I'm hoping that I'll be able to sort it out within the next few seconds. If I just unplug this and replug it in. And replug it in. Okay, let's try again. Seems to have seen it now. Nothing. Right, I'm really sorry, but I don't even know if I'm broadcasting at the moment. I don't actually know what to do. I'm gonna start again.